Azure Data Lake Analytics, what it is, why you want to use it, and of course, how you can make it work for you, all that and more when you join me coming up now. Hello, everybody. My name is Adam Gordon, an entertainer here at ITProTV, back with another fun and exciting episode in our What is Azure serial, where we take on different Azure features and services and explain them to you using three questions. What is the Azure feature or service? Why would you want to use it in your organization? And of course, how it can add value for you and how you can make it work really to your benefit. When we think about the Azure Data Lake Analytics offering, which is what we're going to take a look at in this episode, we're going to answer those questions by talking about massive data scalability, massive data processing, and the ability to take data from anywhere in any format and put it to work. This is what Azure Data Lake Analytics does for us. So let's talk about what the Azure Data Lake Analytics offering really is all about. And I'm going to underline the word analytics here because first and foremost, it's about analyzing data, our ability to take massive amounts of data, petabytes of data, as a matter of fact, potentially, and use our capability to analyze, to ask questions, to extract value from that data, but to do so in some very specific ways, showing the users that are going to consume that data the hidden meaning, and as a result, the hidden value that that data represents. So when we think about what Azure Data Lake Analytics is, it is a massive storage and massive scale query engine that allows us to make sense of our data in any format using any kind of data. In other words, coming from anywhere, looking and feeling like anything, and then using that data to be able to understand the true meaning that that information is going to represent to our organization. Now, in terms of where that data lives, where we can put it, where we can work with it, we've got some different options here. We have Azure Storage Blobs, which is traditionally one of the many ways that we would, and probably more often than not the default way, where we would store data. So we could certainly make our data work for us by putting it in Azure Storage Blobs. We can use the Azure SQL database, traditional SQL-based database. Microsoft makes that available to us in the Azure platform, and we can host our data there. We can have a SQL database running in Azure on a virtual machine if we don't want to use the Azure-based SQL DB directly. We can use Azure SQL data warehouses. Massive scalability requires data warehouses to work with data, and we have that capability. And data lake stores can also be used in order to provide additional capabilities. So at scale, we have lots of different storage options. And so when we think about what the Azure Data Lake Analytics capability provides for us, it is this massive engine that allows us to take in data, unstructured or structured, and then work with it across these different storage areas, asking questions that lead us to better understand and value that data. It really moves us into our next question, which is, why would you want to use this kind of a solution? Well, when you think about the fact that we traditionally, in most organizations, do have a lot of data, but a lot is a relative term. I mentioned petabytes of data just a few minutes ago as we started discussing this. A petabyte of data is a very, very, very large amount. So large, as a matter of fact, that I can't do justice to it on the lightboard in front of us here. I'm going to ask you to imagine the largest amount of something, whether it's jelly beans, whether it's wine bottle corks, whether it's anything you can imagine that's relatively small, and imagine that largest amount you can possibly imagine, and then double that again, and you wouldn't even be close to what a petabyte of data really means. So as a result, we're talking about scaled data that comes in from perhaps millions of different endpoints that is going to flow into a system like the Azure Data Lake Analytics capability and then be available to us. Imagine in the Internet of Things, the IoT kind of endpoint sensors that we often would think about in manufacturing environments, in remote monitoring environments today. Maybe we've got an oil pipeline, and that's 1,000 or more miles long transporting oil. And every 100 feet, we have some sort of sensor that's embedded in the pipeline to tell us how much oil is flowing, if it's at the right temperature, at the right pressure, if there's a leak, all those things. could imagine the volume of data we would generate from one of those sensors, let alone one every 100 feet over 1,000 miles. Take all that data every 5 or 10 seconds as we monitor, 24 hours a day, and then dump that into a system, and that's exactly what we would be seeing here. All that data would be flowing in, coming in, right, to this system, but the reality is it first has to flow in and come into one of our storage areas, wherever that would be, as we've talked about. And then as we have that data arriving, we're then able to create a storage capability that will just massively provide for that storage. And then, as you're going to see when we talk about how we do this, an Azure Data Lake Analytics account is created in Azure. And that's really just an account that represents our ability to use this offering. And that account is then going to be targeted at our data in one or more of these areas. And so what we would do is essentially just create an opportunity to create a connection here that represents our ability to consume the data. And then through the process of asking a question, being able to essentially create a query, and that query can be of one of several types, we're then able to make sense of that data, derive meaning, and ultimately then show that value. When we talk about the querying is really one of the most important elements of why this will be so important to us, because we can query using different languages. We can use our ability to query, in other words, can be driven by different language choices we make, whether it is R, whether it is .NET, whether ultimately it is U-SQL, or what we call U-SQL, which is the use of the SQL language, structured query language, combined with the C language, giving us maximum flexibility and power. We're able to bring that to bear and derive that value using the Azure Data Lake Analytics solution. I'm going to take us on a quick little tour and show us how we set this up, and I'm going to run a sample query for you, showing you just how easy it is to understand this data at scale. Hello, everybody. Time for us to talk about the how. Really exciting stuff whenever we talk about how. We're going to jump into the Azure portal. We're going to take a look at how we spin up that Data Lake Analytics account and ultimately run that sample query I was talking about to show you how quickly we can actually go through a data set, understanding what the value is in there. I'm going to zoom in so you can see that I've searched for the Data Lake service in the All Services area, and I'm about to highlight and click on the Data Lake Analytics option. Let's just zoom in so you can see that real quick. See, I'm in the All Services area. Started searching, comes up at the top, and we're going to click on that. And when we do, we're going to get the option to see the Data Lake Analytics accounts that may already be set up. Now, I've set one up just so that we can get through that part of the process and show you the actual query, but I'm going to walk you through quickly how we add an account here just so you understand that. I'm going to go ahead and show you that we have an add option right up underneath the Data Lake Analytics element. You can see my Courtney CDB account is already there. It's set up as a pay-as-you-go option located in the East US second or two data center in terms of Azure locations. So I'm going to click add. I'm going to go ahead, do that. We get a relatively straightforward form that allows us to provide some basic information. Let's just scroll down and see what's going on in here really quickly. And you'll see we have to provide the project details for our subscription, the resource group we want to put this account into. I've already created one called Data Lake, and my account is in there. But you can either use an existing one by pulling down or creating new. Then the Data Lake Analytics details give a name for the service that we're going to use to create the account, the location of the data center you want this in by region, the existing storage subscription. Again, you'd have that available or use one of several that are available to you. And then the Azure Data Lake Storage Gen 1 account is created. That's our storage account. We saw that as one of the options up on the lightboard as we were looking. Either create new or use existing. And then our pricing package has to be selected. Default is pay as you go. That means you only pay for the services that you need a la carte as you consume query time, runtime, and analytics time as you run through the data sets. Or a monthly commitment where you commit to a certain minimum charge that you're going to be billed even if you're not using that amount of capability. So you make your choices there. Our default is pay as you go. We're going to use that in our demo just to show you what that looks like. And I'll show you what the pricing structure looks like here on the web page in just a moment. You come down here to the bottom, review and create. Next is really just a summary of what you've put in this page. Review and create takes about a minute or so, maybe a minute and a half to spin up. And once you've done that, and you let it run, it will be available. And then ultimately, once the system is set up, you'll be able to come here and click on that link. Now I'm going to click on that link and take us into the solution. But before we go any further, let's just quickly pop out and take a look at the pricing information that I mentioned. And you could see here that with pay-as-you-go details right down below, that we can localize this for our region and our currency. So you can look at this from anywhere in the world. And you'll see that analytics units are billed at $2 per hour under a pay-as-you-go option, localized into whatever currency may be appropriate for you. And if you do monthly commitment packages, you have all the different options here. Pricing varies and changes every so often, so always look for the most recent information. But you could see the kind of levels in terms of the analytics unit hours that you're buying and the amount of the money, right? The actual amount per month you're being billed as a result. And you could see as you scale up, you're paying less per hour, but you're obviously going to still incur some significant costs. So just pay attention to that as you make your pricing decisions. All right, so now that we've got our service set up, our account is available, we see a relatively straightforward environment. Got a bunch of navigational elements over here that allow us to go in and look at overview information, access control. We have settings down here where we can go in and look at pricing and properties, and we can go in and we can get started with different quick wizards that let us do a variety of things. We're not going to get into that level of detail right now. What we're going to focus on over here is our dashboard that shows us the activities that we have incurred or are running, the amount of estimated cost based on billable usage, and jobs that are either currently running or have been run historically. And right at the top, we have the ability to be able to add new jobs in, view existing jobs that may have been run, and or look at some sample scripts and use the data explorer to see the output of jobs that have already been run. Now, I'm going to show you how to create a new job and put a query in just a second, but I've already run a job. And so if I want to do that and take a look at the output, I can go to Data Explorer. And when I do that, I will see that I can go into my storage Gen 1 account that was created. That was part of the wizard that we would have run through to set the solution up. And when I drill down inside of there, you'll see that I can get a listing of the information, including that .csv file, which is the output of the job, the initial query that I just ran before we got started with the demo. So I could see that information here, seeing the actual outcome of the queries that I run easily in a CSV file, and make that available by sharing it with anybody who wants to see that data. So I just wanted you to be able to understand that and see that that is an option. I can view all jobs that have been run and see the status of them. We could see the job I ran right there was run pretty quickly and in a pretty simple fashion using the U-SQL query language. That's the SQL language combined with C that I was talking about. And that's what we're going to use for our demo as well. So let's create a brand new job. I'm going to go ahead and click New Job. And I get this interface that allows me to go in and give a name to the job. I'll do that, specify the analytics units that I want to be able to use and dedicate to this, tells me who the submitter is, my account is there. And then under more options, line number one, it's where I start to write my query. Now I can write the query right in here using any of the supported languages that we want to, .NET, R, U-SQL, et cetera, or I can have it pre-written and just paste it in, which is what I'm going to do. So let me just grab that query because I already have it set up right here. Whoops, that's not the one. That's the one right there. And I'm going to take that, and I'm just going to paste it right in to here. And when I do that, you can see it just adds the line numbers for me, kind of truncating it out and putting it in. Obviously, I have to make sure the syntax is correct. I have no errors, things like that. But it's a relatively straightforward query using the U-SQL language. And you can see it's pretty simple language. Easily understood, looks very much like a standard language set of elements I'm creating, like English would or any normal language would in terms of readability. It's very simple, very easy. I've declared some values there. I've gone ahead and specified in my output line on line number 9 that I wanted to output to, in this case, data1.csv, and I'm ready to go. And so what I'm going to do is go ahead and I'm going to give this a name. Let's call this new job 1. So name it, and then I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to be able to click submit, estimated cost. It tells me roughly how much that will be. It's going to look like it's going to be a very small amount of time and money. Hit submit. We're going to let this run, and you're going to see it goes through a four-step process here. It'll take about 30 seconds or so to run through the cycle. It's preparing it right now, and it gives me an update and updates and refreshes as this runs every 30 seconds approximately. And so we'll see this go through, and then once it is running, the query will start. It will then actually process the query run, and then I will see the outcome, and it will show me that it is successful. And so once this all takes place, we're about to see a refresh here in like a second. We'll see that we're almost all the way through already. And you could refresh yourself manually along the way if you want to, or you can wait for that. I can resubmit the query, I can reuse that script, or even cancel the job if necessary. It's running right now. As soon as it finishes, I will see it is successful because it's a really straightforward query and very simple. And then I'll be able to look at the output in that .csv file, or I can just go on about my business, doing other stuff and come back to it and consume that output at some point. We'll see there. Shows me some basic information as it is processing and running. So it's just showing me graphically what it's doing and kind of laying it out. So we get that nice capability in the file window, or rather in the browser window off on the right-hand side as it popped in. We should get a refresh here. Let's just pop that in. Looks like we are done and successful. We can see here that our progress is 100%. We are done. All green circles, white checks indicate everything is good. We like that. We can see U-SQL was run and used down at the bottom. And now what I can do, just come down to the bottom so you could see everything is there. It lists everything. And we could see the output right there at the bottom of the visual flow. Shows me that it's there. I can click right there if I want just to be able to pull up the output of that file and see that it really just took those two account names I had with the dollar values and put them into a table and made them available for me. File preview shows you that. Imagine this at scale with 100,000 elements or a million or perhaps a billion different data points and being able to then generate a table and interact with that data, going ahead and downloading it and using it as necessary. That's really the value ultimately here of the Azure Data Lake Analytics solution. And that's how we would use this, but just really massively at scale as we add our data sets in. So when we think about Azure Data Lake Analytics, we think about this capability. Hopefully it's a capability that makes sense for you and your organization. If it doesn't, no problem. There's many other Azure features and services that will. We continue to go over them and explore them in our What is Azure serial. Invite you to come back and spend more time with these. We'll come back with additional episodes, always looking at cutting edge features, solutions, and capabilities that are going to potentially be of value and interest to you. I'll be back with more of those, but until I am, I'm going to wish you happy Azuring and remind you, as I always do, to check me out over at ITProTV. If you want to see more about Azure Data Lake Analytics and or any of the other Azure features and services we go over here, because I have training that I put together and host on ITProTV that covers all of this and so much more. I'll see you soon.